adjust to changing times.
I execute the office of President of the United States.
Challenge a new generation of young Americans.
My biggest fantasy when I was a kid was that I would go to see my favorite band play, and someone would come out and say, "Sorry, the band can't play tonight. Their drummer broke his fucking leg," unless there's someone that knows all the songs. And then, of course, I would jump up and be the greatest drummer in the world. I fantasize about that. With Nirvana, the process of making the music was so entirely simple and pure and real. Kurt was a great lyricist, he had a beautiful voice, and he wrote really simple songs. There were things that I learned about songwriting from being in a band with Kurt that I don't think anyone else could have taught me. That record, Nevermind, came out almost a year to the day after I joined the band.
The song is called Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Before David joined the band, there was a message on my answering machine from Kurt saying, "Butch, we have the best drummer in the world. He's the greatest drummer in the world. I'm not kidding you. He's awesome, dude." And he hung up. About a week later, we were in LA and I walked into a rehearsal space with him. And Dave walked up, skinny, long hair. He's like, "Hey man, I'm Dave. Nice to meet you." He was just full of energy. And I was like, "Well, let's play me some songs, you guys. Play me some songs." And they played Teen Spirit. Dave did the ba-boom, 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 and it just floored me.
Of course, everybody was telling the band that they thought we were great, but I don't think the three of us ever believed a word of anything anyone was telling us. We never thought we were going to sell a million records.
None of us had any idea that it was going to completely change my life and their lives, but I knew that they sounded really tight and pretty focused, and that they had written some amazingly powerful songs.
We knew something was happening because the atmosphere of the gigs just changed. They went from being cool, hipster, underground people in a club to, like, jocks were coming to the show. That was the first thing. Like, "Oh my God, there's jocks here," you know? "It's kind of strange. What, they like our music? We used to kick my fucking ass for listening to this music."
I was a really big fan of Nirvana, like everybody else. And I happened to be reading an interview with Kurt where he had mentioned in the interview, Nirvana was always meant to be a four-piece. It's meant to be a two-guitar band. It was never meant to be a three-piece. And I thought, oh, well, that's my N.
Pat is from this legendary punk rock band called The Germs that we all grew up listening to. There was no one more badass than The Germs. Germs didn't give a fuck. So Pat shows up in Seattle, and all of us were just like, oh my God, hey, it's Pat Smear from The Germs. He's alive?
So now Nirvana is hitting the big halls, with guitarist Pat Smear helping to make the loud louder.
The day before the first rehearsal, I saw my picture on MTV News saying, Nirvana has a new guitar player, Pat Smear, blah, blah. I was like, oh my God, it's real. There it is.
I don't think Kurt wanted to be a huge fucking rock star. And I don't think he could handle how complicated it had all become. No one was very happy with the tour or the band.
So Kurt decided he wants a break, even though we're on this tour that you can't get out of because you're a big band, you get sued.
We had like a week and a half off in between two legs of the tour. I decided to fly home, and Kurt went to Rome, where he was meeting Courtney Love, his wife.
Hi, I'm Tabitha Soren with MTV News. Nirvana frontman Kurt Cobain was hospitalized in a coma in Rome, Italy on Friday morning.
I turn on the TV and Kurt was being wheeled away in an ambulance in Rome.
I went to the hospital with him and I didn't know what to do because I thought, do I say, this is Kurt Cobain, take care of him right away, VIP? Or do I say, this is just some guy, don't call the press? I finally went with, this is Kurt Cobain. VIP, do something about it.
Nirvana spokespeople reported encouraging signs, saying they'd been told Kurt Cobain was responding to his name, opening his eyes, and squeezing his wife's hand.
When he came home, I remember talking to him on the phone and saying, hey man, I don't want you to die, okay? And he was very apologetic. No, I'm sorry, it's a big mistake. Took these pills, I was drinking these champagne, and was in Rome. It was just made a mistake.
It was really sad. I had a message from Kurt, but I wasn't home. And so whatever help he needed from me, I couldn't help him. And that's the last time I ever talked to him or saw him.
When I found out that he had killed himself, I was kind of numb. I knew that he was gone, but I didn't know how to feel.
Kurt Cobain, a sweet and gifted man, dead at the age of 27. To Courtney Love, one-year-old Frances Bean Cobain, Dave Grohl, Chris Novoselic, and Pat Smear, our deepest sympathies.
Everybody knew Kurt was in a bad way, but that's something you never expect to happen. You know, when someone's that down and out, you still can't comprehend that they're actually going to commit suicide. You know, it was terrible.
After Kurt died, I didn't want to play music. I didn't want to play the drums.
When Kurt died, it wasn't just that my friend died. It was my whole life kind of died around it and with him, you know? And I quit the music business.
At some point, I was finally motivated. Ugh, I'm gonna get myself out of this funk I've been in for the last 8 months or whatever it was, you know? I decided that I was gonna take my favorite songs that I had written over the last 4 or 5 years that no one had heard, and I was going to record them at a 24-track studio down the street from my house. And it was really exciting because I was doing it totally by myself. I didn't know why I was doing it. I just wanted to do something, you know? So I booked a week at the studio, and at the end of the week, I had a cassette, and it sounded good. And I started thinking, I won't put my name on it. People will imagine it's just a band, and they won't know that it's the guy from Nirvana. In the middle of that session, I get a call at the studio that Tom Petty wants me to come play drums for him on Saturday Night Live. I just thought, oh my God, he's a hero of mine. And I had the opportunity to join the band if I wanted to join the band. I really had to kind of choose. But was I going to play drums with Tom Petty, or was I gonna start over from scratch and be the lead singer and guitar player of a band, do something I'd never done before that I was terrified doing? Believe me, man, it was not easy to tell Tom Petty that I wasn't going to be his drummer. It was not an easy decision to make. I could still see my hand just putting the phone down and thinking, okay, see what happens. There's a band in Seattle called Sunny Day Real Estate, and a good friend of mine told me that Sunny Day Real Estate were playing a show and that it was going to be their last show because they were breaking up.
My band was falling apart at about the same time that that Dave found himself without a band.
We were broken up while we were doing the tour. We decided that we weren't going to do it anymore, but had already booked this tour, so we were like, well, this will be the last whatever thing we do. And it was ironic because that was the first tour that we were playing shows where people were actually showing up. We're like, oh, wow, well.
I went to the show to see them play knowing that it was probably the last time anyone was gonna see them play. And I was watching them thinking, that's a really good rhythm section. I gave them the cassette thinking like, hey, check it out. Maybe we could jam sometime.
Dave was the first famous person I'd ever met. You know, he's just out of Nirvana, you know, like, that was a very big deal.
I remember the first time that Nate and William and I got together to jam. It was over at William's parents' house.
I remember going up to William's parents' kitchen and sitting there after we played, and Dave just goes, you guys wanna be in the band? And I was like, hell yeah.
Playing in front of people, it was very difficult for me. I did have a conversation with Dave, and I said, you know, man, I don't think that I should do it. And Dave said, that's exactly why you're the guy that has to do it. And I don't know what that meant, but that convinced me, I guess.
After having that rehearsal, Dave brings up that he wants to have a second guitar player and he thinks it should be Pat Smear, who William and I knew from him having played in Nirvana and having been in the Germs.
Then Dave came over and he gave me a cassette. And I listened to that whole tape, just front to end, and I thought it was all great.
I didn't have anything against Pat. I didn't know him as a musician. I didn't know him as a person. But he lived in Los Angeles, and I just thought that was fucking crazy. The way I'd grown up, you were in a band with your friend from high school that you saw every day, and you'd go home after school and get together in somebody's mom's house or basement and work it out. Like, but you can't do that. The guy lives in Los Angeles. Pat came up, he played, and he was perfect. So I got over that, him living in LA thing. I think I might have talked to him about trying to move to Seattle. I'm not sure.
All of us came from bands that ended prematurely.
We didn't really talk about our former bands. For me, it was always kind of a touchy subject. At this point in time, Kurt had only been dead for a year, and I didn't want to talk about it.
So we all entered into this new band like it was helping us get through the loss of the bands that we'd been in before.
I remember it really vividly, Dave saying, like, let's have it be fun. Let's have things be out in the open. Let's talk about shit. Just no drama.
You know, and he was like, and, you know, don't want it to be, like, a stressful thing. We're not going to, like, tour into the ground. And, which I was glad about.
The first tour that we did was with a musician named Mike Watt. He is a legendary punk rock bass player. And he asked me if I would tour with him. And I said, yeah, man, how about this? I'll be in your band if my band can open up on tour. And Eddie Vedder from Pearl Jam had done the same thing. And we said, cool, let's put together a tour where Eddie's other band, they were called Hovercraft, my band, Foo Fighters, would open up for Watt, and we would all be his band. It was just this, like, revolving cast of musicians. Each song would have a different lineup.
Instead of getting a tour bus for the first tour, like, we'll get a van. I'd never done a bus tour at that point in time, so to me it was totally obvious, you know, like, yeah, we'd get a van. What, we gotta buy a brand new one? Ha! Awesome!
We had played 6 shows a week, and the places held maybe anywhere from 300 to 600 people, and Foo Fighters were making, I think, $500 a night or something like that.
As the tour was going on, the venues were getting bigger, and they started having that really nice but weird sort of pressure.
A lot of attention because it was Dave's first tour after Nirvana.
The shows had all these Nirvana fans that came.
And they didn't know any of the songs because the record hadn't been out yet. So there was a song called Marigold by Nirvana that Dave had written and sang on. And it was the only thing they knew to yell out when we were playing. So you'd just hear, Marigold!
Marigold! Marigold! Marigold! Marigold!
And we never played it. How weird that must have been for Dave.
Arriving in record stores Tuesday was one of the most buzzed about new releases of the year, the self-titled debut album by Nirvana drummer Dave Grohl's new band, Foo Fighters, who wowed crowds on Mike Watt's recent club tour.
Personally, to me, it was a big deal when that record came out, because rather than go in and record something as a band, we used the stuff I had recorded on my own, that cassette. That's the first record.
Making their network television debut right here with us. We couldn't be happier. Ladies and gentlemen, Foo Fighters.
When I talk about it, Aries or treason's already new. Beg me to talk about.
To think of this award as some sort of closure. It's stop throwing Mentos at us at our shows. That's what I'm trying to say.
Never was it true, but it's you.
there were lots of interviews and, you know, Dave not wanting to talk about Nirvana.
Every question in every interview was about Nirvana. You can imagine what they were, you know, like, is this song about Kurt? Take any song from the record. Is that song about Kurt Cobain?
This song has nothing to do with Kurt Cobain, yet I do owe more than I could possibly express to him, so.
What's it like to be at a press conference and not being asked any questions?
It's fine with me because I didn't really want to fucking answer any of the questions that were asked.
It's an entirely different band, so I don't really compare the two at all.
There were some people that really resented me for starting this band. How dare you fucking start another band? They asked me, like, why did you decide to carry on and make music that sounds like Nirvana? And I said, well, wait a minute. What do you mean? Like loud rock guitars and melodies and cymbals crashing and big ass drums? Because that's what I do. I was in that band and this is like, that's what I do. Oh, you want me to fucking make a reggae record? The first couple years, I really felt like I had to explain and defend what I was doing because, first of all, you're just a drummer. And what, you're trying to sing? And also, you were in Nirvana, so what the fuck is this shit? So you just get to the point where you just think, you know, you think, fuck you people.
Write more songs, or how is the writing process going to work? Will we suck? I had no idea, like, does this band have a future or not? And I knew that we were going to be okay and be able to continue after I heard the song My Hero, because it was great.
There were some songs that we just writing and throwing into the set. There were only a couple songs that we had that were really good openers. I thought, God, I need to write like an opening song for us. In Europe and in England, when bands play, the audience doesn't really like beat the shit out of each other like they do in America. They do this bounce, right? Everybody bounces. So I wanted to write a song that everyone would like start bouncing to when we first came out and played. So I had a melody and a riff idea, but I didn't know the tempo, so I jumped up and down and I found a tempo by like bouncing. Tempo should be this. I wrote the song, I brought it to soundcheck. I said, hey, I have this new song, let's learn it so we can open with it tomorrow night or tonight or whatever. So we soundchecked, we ran through it. The next night we opened up that song, the audience was going, it worked. Cool. Let's keep it. I was waiting for something, maybe flying machines. That's when I found it. Yes, I have to see. Put him on the ceiling, try to make him my own. People like him to see, but they never seem to be in their space.
Played like 18,000 shows in 1 year. I'm exaggerating, but it felt like. Then we just toured a lot.
Pat was keeping track. And I remember Pat was always like, he'd just every other day look at me and be like, 12 months, 13 months, 16 months. And I was just like, I remember each time he would like tell me, I'd be just like, no fucking way.
We've been on tour for so long, and we've been a band for almost a year now. And I'd say about 7 months out of that year has been spent on the road.
I wasn't some kid who was just like, yeah, at that point. I was just kind of like, you know, I'm older and I'm lazier.
What?
And still I'm playing the same 20 songs 200 or 300 nights a year.
This song's called For All the Cows. This song is called For All the Cows. It's called For All the Cows. This song's called For All the Cows. This song's called For All the Cows.
Second album that we made, Color and Shape, we decided to work with this producer named Gil Norton. And Gil, at the time, was famous for making the Pixies records.
This is my first real recording process. Now there's a producer, like someone who's not just pressing play, but actually is saying, like, I think that should be a C, and you should also play it in time.
We went into the studio with Gil, and he worked us hard, real hard.
I was fucking terrible, and William was having his own challenges.
Gil called Nate and I the rhythmless section, so that was encouraging.
I could tell when, you know, I had to do something a million fucking times that it was taking longer than I wanted to, and it was just sort of my first realization, like, oh, I'm not a fully formed musician. Like, I've got to keep getting better.
Constantly, there was this feeling that whatever song we were working on, Dave had a drum part for it already in his head or whatever.
When I've written a song, I have kind of a clear idea of where the basic root accents should lie. That's a fancy way of saying I know what the drums should sound like in my head as I'm doing this thing. That's not necessarily fair to say that as a songwriter, you know, who's collaborating with other musicians.
You're the drummer for a band where your singer is the greatest rock and roll drummer in the world, looking over your shoulder, waiting for him to do it as good as him. All right, that's just fucked up pressure. I mean, regardless of how good you are or whatever it is, it's just fucked up pressure. And remember that William was a kid. I mean, he was really young.
I think that William played the best that he could, and sometimes it was great, and sometimes it wasn't.
What sucked about all that was, you know, I mean, I don't think maybe the drum performances were the best. They weren't horrible.
If I listen to a song and I don't think it has the thing that it needs, it's not necessarily going to get past me and get on an album.
We left Seattle and went to Los Angeles to a different studio to finish this thing up. And Dave comes in, he's like, listen, we're gonna redo, you know, My Poor Brain or whatever the song is. Drum track's not quite right. I'm doing the drums on this one. We're just gonna redo it. William's up in Seattle at this point in time.
They'd call me down and say, oh, we need you to come play guitar in a song. And I'd go down and I'd be like, well, I already played this song. Well, we did it over. Oh, okay. You know, do it again. And then I go home, and then I get called down again. And they're like, oh, come down and play. I'm like, all right, cool, let's do it. I already played this song, and it just kept happening that way. I was like, what the fuck is going on here?
And this happens 3 or 4 times. Like, hey, we're gonna try this one again.
And then it just ended up like, wait a minute, we're just doing this whole album over. I just remember asking someone, does William know?
William's still up in Seattle, so he doesn't know what's going on. He doesn't know that this is happening. And I'm stressing pretty hard because it's, you know, that's going to be a big problem.
I was like, you know, what's going on? Should I, you know, book me a flight down there? I should go down. I should be down there. And then Dave calls me and he was like, dude, don't come down here. And I was like, why? And he goes, I'm redoing a couple of the drum tracks. And I was like, whoa, okay. And I met with Nate. And so I said, what's going on? And Dave's redoing a couple of the tracks. And he goes, is that what he told you? And I said, yeah. And he goes, he redid them all.
The conversation that I eventually had with William was that I really wanted him to stay in the band, and I really wanted him to be the drummer, but I was going to play drums on the record.
I don't know whether it was management, the record company, Gil, all the above, Dave, that wanted him to play drums and didn't want me to play drums or whatever, but him redoing the drum parts has never been explained to me.
It's a tough thing to talk about because I know that William will never forgive me for playing drums on that record. I know it. And I wish things were different. But I felt like this is what I had to do in order to make this album happen.
We talked and Dave said, you know, I still want you to, you know, tour the record, you know. And I was just like, dude, I mean... I have to, you know, as it is now, I have to rebuild my soul or refind it. If, you know, I mean, it's like, if I do that, it's like, see ya. So, thanks, but no thanks.
It was a really weird time. And I was young. What the fuck?
Heard on the radio, Foo Fighters drummer has left the band. And I was like, whoa, really? I wonder if they have a drummer yet. I remember vividly my brother saying, you know, you should be in this band. And I was like, well, fuck, yeah, that'd be great, wouldn't it? You know, I would have loved to have been in The Who and James Addiction and Led Zeppelin, too.
Around that time, Taylor Hawkins is playing drums with Alanis Morissette, and she was blowing up. I'd seen him play before, and there's no question the dude's a monster on the drums.
It's funny, because back there's Taylor just looking like, just like killing it. Like, oh my God.
We all love Taylor, but he was in a band, and he was in the biggest band around at the time.
We were kind of in a pinch, you know? We had just recorded this record, and we had to go out and start doing shit.
So Dave calls him up and is like, hey man, do you know any good drummers?
It's like, yeah, I'll be your fucking drummer. Let me try out.
I remember saying to Taylor, you realize that we're not as big as Alanis Morissette.
I'm like, I know, but I want to be in a band and I want to be part of something like that. And so, and he said, well, you know, if you try out and if we jam and you have to be in the band.
Dave called me like, you remember Taylor? Like, oh yeah. It's like, yeah, I think he'd be the drummer. And I reacted poorly to that.
When I was hanging out with Dave and me and him were bouncing off the walls and everything, and Nate was just going, oh no, not another one of these fucking guys. I can't take two of these spazzes in one band.
I didn't think our personalities were compatible. You know, he's just this like outgoing, like Southern California surfer dude.
Say something funny.
I don't know anything funny.
You know, I just came from a different world, and I was like, that guy, he is not a guy I'm going to be in a band with. No way. It's like, he's really good. Okay.
フーファイターズとお送りしている MTV ロックス、ドラマーがね、今度新しくまた加わったということなんで、その辺をね、聞こうと思うんだけど。
About your new drummer? Yeah, you got a new drummer.
Got a new drummer?
Yeah, from the Alanis Morissette band.
That's right.
Yeah.
His name's Taylor Hawkins, and... Is that his last name?
Yeah, I think it is.
He's really new.
We just met him.
He's really new.
So now Taylor's in the band, and he comes in his first day at rehearsals, and Pat quits the band. right then and there.
Pat says, hey, you guys, can I talk to you guys for a second? And we said, yeah, sure. We walk outside and he goes, I gotta leave the band. I'm like, what the fuck? Why?
I was just so sick of it. I was just so sick of the whole thing. I want to go out on another, you know, bazillion show tour, and I don't care. I just don't want to do this anymore.
When you join a band the first week, and one of the members decides, like, ever since you've been there, he's going to quit, you're like, obviously it's me.
I was shocked. I was shocked. I begged him to stay in the band. He said, no, man. I'm just not into it anymore.
Like, essentially, right when we're about to go out and start our tour, like, here's these new songs, Pat quits, and so he's kind of got us in a bad spot.
I asked him to stay until we could get someone to replace him.
So we made a deal that I would tour for 6 weeks till the new guy was ready, but it stretched out to, I think, 6 months, maybe.
So Pat's quit the band, but he's still playing with us. That gives us some time to integrate Franz Stahl, being the second guitar player in the band.
I'd known Dave for years. We grew up in the same city. And he was in my first band, this punk rock band called Scream.
When I left Scream to join Nirvana, the one relationship that felt the most strained was my relationship with Franz. I think that he resented me for leaving. It took a while, and then we reconciled and we became friends again, and that moment where Pat said, I don't want to be in the band anymore, I immediately thought, I'm going to call Franz.
I was on tour in Japan, and I get the phone call from Dave, and wants to know if I'd like to join the Foo Fighters.
There wasn't any sort of musical audition. I just thought, hey, Franz, you want to be in the Foo Fighters? He said, yes.
And then the next day, I was on the roof of Radio City Music Hall.
Please give a warm welcome to Foo Fighters.
We were playing at the MTV Awards on top of the marquee. It's kind of like a warm-up act.
And so I played the first song, and then I quit. And then Franz came up, and he joined.
It happened just so fast. And I was still jet lag from Japan.
Hello! Last song we played was my last song with the band. I would like to introduce you to Franz Stahl, who will be taking over.
Hi.
Thank you. Rock on, guys! Foo Fighter!
It was all very new to me because I was always used to slumming it, you know, like sleeping on people's floors and just getting by, you know? And this was a whole new level. When I joined the Foo Fighters, it was like, you know, you made it, you hit it, and you're getting recognized for it. It was awesome.
Once Franz joined the band, we did what we always did. We went on the road. We played as many places, as many shows as we could. And it was starting to grow. Like, you could see there were 2,000 people, 3,000 people, 4,000 people at gigs. We were no longer playing the afternoon slot at the festival. We were playing the evening slot at the festival. And there was a song on the radio, Everlong, and all of a sudden there were videos on MTV, and it was happening to us, that thing that happens to new bands when they start to get popular.
Got Franz.
That's right.
Myself.
That's right. Franz joined the band on air.
And that was a great big surprise.
It was awesome, man. And it's the best year we've ever had as a band. And Franz is, you know, he's the dude. She sang.
I love the first two records. And there wasn't a song that I didn't enjoy, you know? And I certainly was looking forward to writing and you know, putting, leaving my mark.
Franz is a great guy and a sweet guy, and I was actually got really close with him. And it just seemed like it would be perfect.
We were rehearsing and writing at the time and coming up with song ideas, and Taylor and Nate and I seemed to have this thing where we were on the same page and we were jamming and coming up with something together. And Franz just didn't seem to find his place in all of that.
In Scream, I wrote all the music. You know, I wrote the majority of it. My brother would write the lyrics, you know. So I was always, I was very hands-on, you know. But it was Dave's band, and he writes all the music. I was kind of leery of pushing my ideas, you know, so I wasn't trying to be as vocal about it.
For some reason, the four of us together wasn't right. It never congealed into feeling like a band. It's just chemistry.
We had a talk with Dave about it, and he didn't want to hear it, but he knew that that's what the situation was.
My relationship with Franz is much different than everybody else's relationship with Franz. I'd known the guy since I was 18, and we had cut our teeth together. It was tough, man. I mean, honestly, like, it was just, you know, a great old friend of mine that, unfortunately, I was asking to leave the band. And that's not to say that he's not a fucking great musician, because, of course, everybody knows he is, but when we worked together as four people, it just didn't gel, you know?
We got on some kind of conference call or something and told him we were gonna get a different guitar player, and there was some, a lot of sadness and drama surrounding that. It was ugly.
Basically, I got a phone call. I got a fucking phone call. And it just all ends right there. I don't even know how to react, you know?
There's just no nice way of saying you're out of the band, you know?
I'm not exactly sure what happened. You know, I was in the band, and for whatever reason, I was out of the band. But, I mean, it was the best 2 years of my life. You know?
Most bands go through the same shit that we had been through up until that point before anybody's ever heard of them. Unfortunately, we went through all of those embarrassing, growing pains in public. By 1998, I would sit down to do an interview and people would say, okay, so fucking who's in the band right now? Has anybody else left in the last month and a half? But there was always Nate. I was staying at my mother's house, and I got a call from Nate. So what's up, man? He goes, I gotta leave the band. And I just thought, oh, Jesus fucking Christ. I said, okay. At this point, my response to a member leaving was like, all right, why?
Certainly, real estate had gotten back together. And I had a lot of really formative experiences with them. So I had this like high school crush, kind of irrational attraction to that project. And I was tortured, and I called up Dave.
And I was fucking pissed. And I think I told him, okay, you know what? You call everyone and tell them you quit. I'm gonna go fucking get drunk.
As soon as I got off the phone, I knew it was the wrong thing to do, that I was gonna be happier in Foo Fighters. It was a better thing for me to be doing. I called a couple friends, like, I just quit the band. I feel really weird about it. Yeah, it's like, yeah, because that was a dumb idea.
Me and my buddy Jimmy took my rental car out to Ribster's. We got fucking shit-faced, rallied my rental car, fucking threw rocks at it all night, busted out windows, drove other people's lawns, and I wound up stumbling home and woke up at 7 in the morning in the bedroom that I grew up in as a kid with my mom saying, David, Nate's on the phone.
I called him the next morning at like 6 a.m. I was wigged out, and I think it caught him off guard. And
I'm sorry, man, I don't really want to quit the band. I don't know what I was thinking.
He's like, good. I was like, yeah, this is better. Sorry about that.
I was still wasted, too. I was just lying in bed like, I love you, man. I'm glad you don't want to quit. So we decided that we're going to make this next record as a three-piece. I'm in the sky tonight. We had just made this super hyper-produced record, which we slaved over and lost two band members. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to buy a house in Virginia. I'm going to build a studio in the basement. And we're going to make this record without any fucking record company and no pressure and no one telling us what to do.
It was different just having the three of us there, but, you know, we're starting to form a good identity for the band. That's when Dave was first starting to become more comfortable as a lyric writer.
Song like Ain't It the Life, so without realizing what I was doing, I was kind of making this wish list of all the things in life I wish I had.
We weren't really on a major deadline. Our friend Adam Casper was down there engineering and co-producing.
Did all of those vocals sitting on a couch.
It was just a laid-back record, and you hear it.
And the Grammy goes to?
The Grammy goes to?
Learn to Fly, Foo Fighters.
There's nothing left to lose, Foo Fighters.
We won three Grammys for that record, and I remember standing there at the podium making the speech, looking out at all those people in tuxedos and diamonds and shit, thinking, I bet you this is the only record made in a basement that's gonna win a Grammy this year. And I was so fucking proud.
Take care. Thank you very much, everybody.
Come on, camera. And roll sound.
Roll playback.
We take our music really seriously, but music videos? They're commercials. They're candy commercials. So why not make fun of the process?
Run and tell all of the angels. Could take all night.
But once we got into it, I started having fun with it, and it became a trademark for this band.
Hook me up a new evolution.
Trying not to take ourselves too seriously. You know, like in videos a lot of times, you can easily get caught up in that. You know, we're playing on a mountaintop. The wind's blowing in your hair, and you know, there's an eagle flies down and lands on your shoulder. Some, you know, like they...
Looking for a sign of life. Looking for something to help me find out right. I'm looking for complications.
I just think that's a sort of a outlet of our humor. I mean, I've seen Dave do stuff on videos where I'm being such a fucking goofball. I'm not as good at it. You know, I did try to make us a trio. Dude, Police! We're a trio!
Musically, we needed more guitar.
Part of the sound of the Foo Fighters is a lot of guitars. It's just part of the sound. We argue about it every time we mix a record because I always want the drums louder, and Dave's like, that's just, it's the Foo Fighters. The guitars are really loud.
None of us had, like, the right guy that was a friend or a friend or a friend, or that this wasn't handy, so we had to have open auditions for a guitar player.
Pin a note at the Guitar Center, like, guitar player wanted for Foo Fighters.
We wound up in this rehearsal space, and I just remember this line of guitar players, and I was terrified.
That was great. I mean, I dig it. Nice meeting you for the first time. Hopefully see you again soon.
There's the guy that came in and hugged everybody. And I was like, hi. Hi.
There's one kid that came in. He was so nervous. He came in. He's like, hey, man, what's up? Hey, will you sign something for me? He just immediately wanted us to sign some shit. And we're like, yeah, dude, yeah, cool. It's cool, you know, just relax. Let's hang, you know, let's talk. We hung out and talked a little bit. And then he went to open up his guitar case, and it was locked.
He got a brand new guitar, a brand new case, and he fucking locked his guitar in it and didn't have a key.
We literally did like fucking a week or two of tryouts. And I remember there was one point where it was getting a little dire. We're like, fuck.
A good friend of mine called me and said, hey, I heard Guns N' Roses are auditioning guitar players, and I think I could get you an audition. And I was like, well, I don't want to audition for Guns N' Roses. But I said, but I heard that Foo Fighters guitar player quit. See if they're, you know, try to get me an audition with Foo Fighters.
Everyone, shake hands with Chris.
Chris.
When Chris came into audition, we somehow came to the realization that we met when we were kids at a punk rock show in Santa Barbara.
Years and years before any of this, when Dave had been the drummer in this band called Scream, and I was playing bass in a band called Rat Pack, and we actually opened up for him.
The fact that he was a part of that underground punk rock thing was really important to me. So we bonded pretty instantly because I thought, all right, he's gonna get it. He's gonna understand, and he won't take this shit for granted.
Sing, and he was a shredder, and he was a good guy, and he'd been in bands, and he didn't smell, and he was awesome.
So the next day, just all day, I just sat there by the phone, and at like around 5 or 6, the phone rang, and it was Dave and Taylor, and they said, you know, all right, you know, you got the gig, we start rehearsing tomorrow, say goodbye to your friends, you know, you're not going to see anybody for the next year.
It was like Chris joined the band, and we had our itinerary ready to go. Okay, ready? We're gonna leave for fucking 10 years, let's go.
The Foos found their new best buddy in Chris Shiflett, a former member of punk bands No Use for a Name and 22 Jacks.
I remember like wanting to kind of like help Chris feel comfortable. Like we went out to dinner a couple of times. Just trying not to have it be a situation where he just comes in and is just like, okay, go.
When I joined Nirvana, I was the fifth drummer of Nirvana. With Chris, it was maybe the same way, you know? He's the third guitar player of the Foo Fighters.
In the early days, you know, of being in the band, it's like, I didn't want to fucking step on anybody's toes. I didn't even know what, you know, I didn't know what my place was, you know. And I was just genuinely like, this was everything that I ever wanted, you know. This was the dream coming true. Yeah!
Every time Foo Fighters would put out a record, I would get really excited and miss it so bad.
I found out after being in the band for a couple months that they had almost replaced me with Pat. You know, Pat almost came back, who they had a lot of history with, and there was a relationship there. You know, Dave didn't know that I knew that, and probably most of them didn't.
There was at least a couple times where I called Dave and said I went back. Then when it looked like it might actually happen, and then I just got scared.
You know, after being in the band for a couple months, I sort of had this feeling like, you know, this could all end. And I'm gonna enjoy this while it lasts, because it probably will end sooner than I want it to.
That third record, we went on the road with the Red Hot Chili Peppers. For like 4 months, we toured America with them. We had never played arenas before. You know, we hadn't done that arena rock thing.
That's when we started coming up with jams on stage and working out like a show. Not a show, not dancers and shit, a show, but really like kind of work out a good set so that it's impressive.
Taylor really drove that home. It was great because that changed the band probably forever and made us concentrate more on really playing together.
We had a stage setup that we had built for the arena. It was basically modeled after the Queen Live Killers record cover. It was very 70s.
Hi, this is our dressing room. This is where we get dressed before we play.
And we had this like little uniform set. We brought a wardrobe case, and everything was in red and black or white. you know, it was our sort of color theme for the tour. It was the first time we thought about it in terms of things, something like that, you know, like let's look a certain way on stage.
I had the black shirt with the white tie and the black pants, and Nate had the red shirt with the black tie and the red. We looked like Kraftwerk or something like that. It was silly, really. But we put on this show, and we fucking killed it.
Okay, I'll see you guys in a town near you, I hope, very soon. Take care, and I love you.
It just stands to reason, no matter how great of a thing that your life or your job is, after a while, you need a break.
That was fun until after like 2 months of doing it, you start, it feels like Groundhog Day, all those arenas look the same, and you start bringing the bottle of whiskey to the stage with you.
We start out with, let's do a shot before we play. We call it band prayer. And then that turned into like, you know, let's do 10 shots before we play.
And we all started getting fucking hammered before we went on stage, and we got really shitty by the end.
I think that's probably why so many musicians wind up getting so fucked up. It's because you need something to keep it fun.
Taylor had been struggling with drugs, I think. He and I had talked about it a few times, you know?
I didn't really know how to deal with the way you were supposed to be. And I thought that to be a rock and roller, you know, you have to be the fucking Keith Richards. You have to be the dark, partying fucking the real deal. That's the only way it's real rock and roll.
Rock and roll. I would tell him, I'd say, you know, dude, I love you like a brother. I'm not a cop. I'm not your dad, whatever. But I'm worried about you, you know? We were in London, and we all went out to a bar one night across the street from the hotel, and we were having a good time. And I came back to my room early, and in the morning, I got a call that he was on his way to the hospital.
We got word that Taylor's in a coma at the hospital, and OD'd on, you know, whatever it was. I think it was heroin that he did. And our sound man at the time, he was like, oh yeah, Taylor fucked up. He's gonna die. Like he's fucking dead.
It was so weird, like he hadn't died, but he had overdosed. And I just felt so totally helpless, you know?
Instruments.
So I sat with him for those couple weeks until he woke up. And when he woke up, I said to him, dude, it's gonna be okay. And he looked at me and he said, fuck off. And I thought, oh good, everything's gonna be okay.
And Dave's like my best friend. And even more than like a best friend, he's like a brother, he really is. And yeah, he was, as I would be with him, if something happened to Dave where he was on the brink of death, I would be losing my mind. And you know, he was losing his mind. So we get back from London after my fucking OD, and then 2 months after that, we start trying to make this record.
But we weren't ready. And nobody's really into it. Everyone's playing half-assed.
I'd do something, and Dave would listen to it, and say, like, no, this has got to change, and this is not working with the vocals, and that's too busy, and I was disagreeing. So I had a shitty attitude because I was pissed.
It was bizarre. It was my first record with the band, and I was just showing up to the studio every day and was sort of confused, like, it's weird, I'm really never playing on this. I show up at noon every day, and I kind of sit here, and I eat food and drink coffee, and then I go home, and what is this?
There's a little bit of, like, infighting and whispers of blah, blah, blah's pissed at blah, blah, blah about blah, da, 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 and the vibes just were not happening.
Dave's like, I just feel like you guys are just taking the band for granted. Like, it's just show up, and we make a record, and we go on, and we do our thing, and there's no, like, you don't have to show up with the passion for it. And he had a point.
I would walk in, listen to what we have, and think, I don't really know if I want anyone to hear this.
The making of that record was a fucking... sucked.
We finished it, and we gave it to our manager, John Silva, and he's like, well, like, we could put this out, but I don't know if we're going to be able to sell any of them. Immediately following that, Dave had done a record with Queens of the Stone Age as their drummer and went out and toured on that record. I was like, I'm going to go do this, and we'll visit this. We'll figure out what we're going to do about this record that didn't work later.
Dave's not happy with the record, and he wants to shelve it, and he's also going to go on tour with Queens of the Stone Age. And so it was kind of like, whoa, he's doing what? You know, what are we doing again? What'd you say? No.
I just started to think that we should stop. I don't have to be here. And I really fucking love doing this other thing. So, fuck it.
So, you know, he went off with Queens, and that went on for a little while. And then we got together to rehearse to go play Coachella.
We were signed on to do this show where Dave was playing with Queens the day before, and then we were playing.
There was so much tension, and nobody was talking, and we were just rehearsing to get through these songs.
God bless him. Chris, at one point in time in the rehearsal, goes, hey, I don't know if I'm the only one, but, like, you cut the air in here with the fucking knife. What the fuck's going on? And then it was just on.
And we had this big fight, one of the biggest arguments we've ever had.
It was mostly between Taylor and Dave that had it out, like, the serious discussion, stuff that had been pent up.
When I went off to play drums with Queens of the Stone Age, Taylor totally resented me for that.
What bands are you listening to now?
Well, the new Queens of the Stone Age CD is amazing. Everybody knows that.
He said he was really upset that I didn't come see him play drums and how exciting it was for him, you know, to be back on stage playing with another band. I just went through this awful trauma, and, you know, I was supposed to be happy that Dave's having such a good time, but I wasn't, you know. I wasn't fucking happy for you to go play with another band. What? Why should I be happy for that? So Dave was trying to write the set list for the show, and the argument about it, and just, you know, you're a fucking asshole, and if you don't like it, you can fucking leave. And the next day I said, I will be leaving as soon as we finish this. As soon as we play Coachella and we finish this record and do whatever commitments we have, then I'm out of here.
Look, let's go and do the show, and then if we never want to do it again, then let's not do it again.
If the Foo Fighters are over, the Foo Fighters are over. And I'm okay with that.
Okay. That's it. Oh, well. I played two nights at that Coachella, one with the Foo Fighters and one with Queens of the Stone Age. And Taylor sat and watched Queens of the Stone Age that night at Coachella.
At that point, I was okay with it. I didn't care anymore. I was like, well, this is probably our last show. So, you know, maybe Dave will just end up being Queens of the Stone Age drummer for now or whatever, and that'll be what it is. Ease me with the feeling that I feel the most. And then we played the next day, and we played great. Dave was like a new front man in front of 10,000, 20,000 people, however big that fucking thing is. And it was really good. And after that, me and Dave went for a walk, and he said, you know, let's go back to Virginia and record a couple songs.
We made a plan to meet and just jam, see what happens. And I said, well, I have this new song. It's called Times Like These. We'll be right back.
songs like these was basically written about the band disappearing for those 2 or 3 months and me feeling like I wasn't entirely myself. Thought, okay, I'm not done being in the band. I don't know if they are, but I'm not.
It wasn't too long before Dave was excited to get back to work on the record.
We just started picking all the songs and going, well, fuck, let's re-record that. We have a week.
And we re-recorded the album in 7 days in my basement. It's times like these you
learn to live again. It was all finished really quickly, and it had the passion, and it had the feel and the sound that was like a record that we could be proud of.
I remember that being like the turning point, like, okay, this is an ending.
We had already spent 3 months and $1 million on something that we threw away. The difference between All My Life and All My Life was that this one cost $1 million and sounded like crap. This one, we did in my basement in half an hour and became the biggest fucking song the band ever had. All my life I've been searching for something, something never comes. It was a big record, you know? Millions of people bought it. All My Life, we just have to play when we play gigs.
And to this day, that's by far my favorite song to play live. You know, every night, it's a good or bad show, doesn't matter. Like, when you get to that part of the set, it always goes bananas. If you're having a bad show, it's like, that's the turning point every night.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Foo Fighters!
Ladies and gentlemen, Foo Fighters.
Please welcome back to the program, Foo Fighters.
Foo Fighters! Ladies and gentlemen, Foo Fighters! I love it, but I hate my taste. We're keeping me down. I love it, but I hate my taste. We're keeping me down.
We barely got through making a record. And then started kind of going up the ranks as a live band.
We didn't have all this huge success right up front. It's just been these little milestones of things that we've been asked to do and have been able to do.
You know, it was a fun time. You know, we were doing these great tours and the shows were getting bigger and we were on a good roll.
We'd get asked to play on the MTV Awards and we'd show up and we'd be the only fucking rock band there. So it'd be like us and fucking boy bands, girl bands, rappers, solo artists. After a while, we got suspicious, like, wait a minute, do they know who we are, or do they just need a rock band?
Thank you.
Lately. After One by One, I went home and started demoing all this really delicate acoustic music. My time is growing thin. I thought, let's make an album where you have one CD that's all the really heavy rock shit, and then you have another CD that's really beautiful acoustic-based, lower dynamic stuff. Skin and bones, don't you? And we'll tour for 6 or 7 months on the rock record and then go out on this theater tour doing the acoustic shows. Since the acoustic record had additional instrumentation, I thought, we need a bigger band.
I always had in the back of my mind that someday I'll get to come and play along with them. And in 2006, Dave called me and said, hey, come out and do this acoustic tour with me.
I didn't actually know Pat, but I was aware that there'd been a couple times through the years when Dave had almost brought him back. And so to me, Pat was just a guy that wanted my job. So when I found out about that, I was just like, oh, you gotta be fucking kidding me.
Pat is a Foo Fighter. Whether he's in the band or not, he and I have gone through a lot together. Pat should be in the band.
I definitely thought it must be awkward for Chris. So I felt awkward only in that I hope this isn't awkward for you.
The first rehearsal, Pat showed up, and we actually instantly like hit it off, you know? And I sort of got to be friends with him over the course of doing those shows.
Clive Davis came to see us play at one of the acoustic gigs. And I said, I think it'd be so cool if we were that band where we did the rock show and we had all the people that love the rock show, and we did the acoustic show and we had all the people that love the acoustic show, and they wouldn't necessarily have to go to both. And Clive was like, yes, but you can do both together. In a total Yoda moment, I was like, oh my God, you're right. And that was the next album, Echo, Silence, Patience, and Grace. Those songs were basically just that. So that tour and that album before totally shaped the one that happened after. Keep you in the dark and sew it all together. Things couldn't get any bigger. We've headlined these festivals, we've played these arenas, we're perfectly happy with the way things are. And then John Silva said, you guys want to play Wembley Stadium? And I said, fuck, okay, but wait, how big is that place? So when you do something like that, you put it on sale, fucking, I don't know, 6 months ahead of time, because that's a lot of tickets, 85,000 people. You're gonna need 6 months to get rid of all those tickets, you know? And we sold it out. I couldn't believe it. So we put another one on sale, and it sold out in like a few days.
And when it sold out like it did, I think everybody in the band was just like, what the fuck, how did that happen?
So it was this huge responsibility, and it's this great thing, like, all right, it's our turn now, like, we have to make it great.
It was 6 months until we had to play the show. Every night before I went to sleep for 6 months, I'd think, oh my God, I have to play. And then I wake up in the morning like, duh, we're playing Wembley. Wembley is so big, and it's like this sort of like monster bowl you're playing in, and just this sort of the weight and the sort of responsibility I put on myself for a show like that, it's intense.
I remember before the first show, I was so nervous. And I somehow got hot sauce in my eye backstage, like right before we went on. I was like, why now? Why does this have to happen now?
You don't just go like, yay, they asked us to do this thing and we're gonna go and we're gonna do our best and see what happens. Like, you want to make sure that it becomes the most memorable show you've done and know that you killed it.
It was nerve-wracking because it's Wembley Stadium, and if you've ever been there, it's so fucking huge. It's like an illusion.
How the fuck did this band get this fucking big? Can you tell me that? I've got another confession to make. I'm your fool. Everyone's got the chains to break. Holding you. Wave on the wrist.
You have 20,000 people and there's nosebleeds that are so far away, you know, you want to be able to bring everybody in. I want the people up there to feel like they're right there. You'd kind of imagine that after playing something like Wembley Stadium and playing to 85,000 people, God, what do we do now?
Yeah, that's good.
And it's the same way with records, in a way. This is our seventh record. What could we possibly do that's different than the last thing we had done?
Be.
And I thought, well, I want to do the next one in the garage. It's about making records the way we used to fucking make records. But let's do it with Butch Vig, so it's fucking huge.
Butch Vig, you know, is probably most well known for doing Nevermind, the Nirvana record. And but he's done, you know, a ton of stuff through the years. You know, he did the last Green Day record, and he was in Garbage. And he's been a working producer for a long time.
Dave said, I want to make the record in my garage.
And then he said, what do you think about making the record on tape?
I want to get away from what people think we should do.
I learned how to make records on tape, and there's something about that process that I love, but you can't fix things like when you're working purely in a digital format. And that's the first thing I said to the band, if we're gonna do this on tape, you guys have to play really well because nothing's gonna be fixed.
I think most people have at least an idea of how records are made now. They're made on computers. You can do whatever with computers, but we all grew up making records on tape. It's got a certain sound. It's got a certain set of limitations. You can't go in and just go like, well, that's close enough.
Wow, this is great.
Rock and roll is imperfection and flaws and four or five or six or eight people playing together, and it's not gonna line up. It's gonna be a little fucked up. It should be, because that's what human beings, you know, human beings aren't perfect.
Say hello.
Hi.
What was really different was the environment doing at Dave's house, which is the most comfortable environment you can imagine. It's like, it's just fun to be there anyways. And I think the atmosphere of where you're recording has to come out on the record. I don't see how it couldn't.
Look at this crew.
Look at the Hawkins.
What, are you kidding me?
The engineers and everybody at one point were like, okay, we're gonna need this and this and this and, you know, $700,000 worth of outboard gear. And Dave's like, no, 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 no. We're making a record in a garage.
I love that we're about to make an album at home. And I think the album's gonna sound like that. I know it will.
If we need to have three different drum sounds, wouldn't it be cool to have them crossfade into each other, like as the other drum sound's starting to come up and the other one's going back?
Wouldn't it be cool if we had a bucket of KFC right now? So in recording, it usually begins with Taylor and I. The drums first with the guitar. And at first, it's really to see if Taylor and I lock in with each other.
Did I miss my cue?
Yes, you did.
I go through a process, sort of a self-loathing, I suck process when I'm recording drums. I tend to think that I'm the worst drummer in the world.
Fuck. Sorry, I messed up the pattern a little bit.
Okay.
Then I go back and listen, and I'm listening to what they're recording. I'm like, ah, I'm all over the place. You know, it's not great.
Sorry, I broke a drumstick.
And then it kind of slowly evolves and comes together after a couple hours. And I have a drum track that I'm really proud of.
The drums are finished.
I'm still not sure about these days. And I can sit there and agonize all day over one little snare hit or fucking the way a groove feels.
And you will.
And I will.
I'll be playing on the radio all the time and you'll be going, I'll just be like, damn, that fucking snare hit.
Maybe we should have just pro-tooled the fuck out of this record. At least you know it's perfect.
Analog like this, knowing that it can't be fixed brings a factor to the way the band thinks about how they're going to play. For instance, Nate, before he would do his bass part, would go out in the tent and work out his part. So when he came into play, he like knew everything he was going to do. We'll be right back.
I think this sounds great.
I think it sounds awesome, man.
Sounds awesome.
Is anybody's the bass
purple
or anything doing?
Rain.
Is,
purple
is the bass or anything doing a note coming out? Is there anything like that?
No.
Is that gonna? You want one? You know what I mean?
I'd maybe not do that.
Don't do that.
Good reaction.
It's very non-confrontational.
Don't do like that.
Maybe don't do that.
I would maybe not ever do that in the song.
I'm the guy that plays the rhythm sort of straight up the middle. And then you have Chris. And Chris has a really, like, sharp and clean sense of melodic playing. And then over here, there's Pat. And it's like, when Pat puts on a guitar, it just goes... So all of those things, if they're balanced, it sounds like Foo Fighters.
Did we finally get too grungy?
It's never too grungy. I wonder if it's just you're losing, like, the notes.
We've had this expanded band now for the last couple albums.
As a musician, it's a dream to be able to play with as many people and do as many different things as you can.
So where should we start? What do you want to start with?
We gotta get Bob fucking rocking and rolling.
What am I doing here? I just learned this. I just learned the song. I know the song. I got it in my head. What do you want me to do?
When you meet someone that really helped you become the musician that you are, I really think it's important to acknowledge that.
Young hearts get shattered. Pick up the pieces coming down around you. You ran away, ran away. It was right on cue.
Bob's voice is so signature, and to have him come to my fucking house and do it on my fucking record blows me away.
All right, cool. You want to do the bridge?
What do you want to do, Bob?
Come on in.
I didn't write the middle section of the song because I wanted to write it with Bob while Bob was there. But I didn't have the words, so I sort of explained it, and we tried it once, just with phonetic crap.
And on now on, and from.
Is that gonna make sense?
I think so.
Okay, let me write something really quick.
Okay, five-minute lyrics.
Okay, give me a five-minute lyric break.
Clock's running.
In from now on, in from now on.
Dad?
Yeah?
Remember you said you'll swim?
I know, I have to write these words really quick so I can go sing it.
Okay.
Okay. One, two, you know what to do.
This was no war, to marry life. This was no war, to marry life. This was no war, to marry life. I'm here from
Top of blue.
That's so good. That is so fucking cool, you guys.
It's good.
It's really good.
Some of the songs still had question marks, you know. The biggest song being I Should Have Known. That song became sort of the X factor in the album. I feel like I Should Have Known is a song that's about Dave's past, and I think there are definitely references in there about Nirvana and about Kurt. Whew. Fucking A, man. It's really good.
When I first started writing that song, it was about someone else that I was involved with, and at the end of the day, I said to myself, I should have known that this was gonna happen.
I should have known.
But when I sing that song, it's hard not to think about all of the times in my life that's happened.
Hey, Chris.
Hello.
We had Chris Novoselic come in and play bass on I Should Have Known. That was a very special moment because I had not been in the same room with Dave and Chris since we finished Nevermind.
Does that back and forth twice, then it does the turnaround chord.
Yeah, it goes D sharp G, D sharp G, F, C. And it goes back in, D sharp G, D sharp.
Oh, it's like a six chord.
Yavol.
How was the tone?
It sounds gnarly.
There, it's done.
It's all you get, motherfucker.
I was not surprised that Dave asked Chris to play on the record. I was surprised it hadn't happened any other time in the last 16 years. You never realize how important the bass sound is to the sound of a band until you put it in another band and go, oh, there it is.
I think what Chris played on the song was the absolute perfect thing for him to do on a Foo Fighters record.
I think that might be the ending. We've found it.
I'm gonna sample my phone.
The ice cream truck.
It usually takes us a while to name an album. But I decided to call the record Wasting Light because I honestly feel like I don't want to let 1 minute of this go without really feeling it.
Thank you.
best way to prepare to playing to 85,000 people is to play it at these small club gigs. Because that's kind of a true test. You go to see an arena rock band. Yeah, they're pretty good, but would they be any good at the Roxy? Having Scream be the first band on the bill, my heroes from my childhood, the band that I dropped out of high school to join, to see them sharing the stage with my band Foo Fighters was a really big deal to me.
Yeah, good night, Chad. Thank you.
Sound like the Foo Fighters because it's me and Taylor and Nate and Chris and Pat. If it were anyone else, it would sound different. You never want to lose anybody, and you never want to see someone disappear out of your life. But we wouldn't be here if it were different with William. We wouldn't be here if it were different with Franz. I feel bad about the bad things, I feel good about the good things. But I wouldn't change a thing. These are my famous last words. My number's a bitch's wow. Oh, won't you let me twist your face? It's getting kind of late. I don't wanna wait no more. Oh, may I have this cancer days locked in your embrace. Past your test of
worked hard and we've made a great band, and I'm completely incapable of doing almost anything else at this point in time, so this is what I do. I'm an adult that plays in a rock band. How about that?
I've had people say, you know, in interviews, like, so Taylor, what is it like to be a rock star? And I'm like, fuck you, I'm not a rock star, I'm a musician.
It's a functional family, you know what I mean? I go to work coming up here, and I just fucking laugh all day and play great music.
Probably always to some extent be that feeling of like this could all end tomorrow. You know, who the fuck knows? You know, we're all pretty lucky that we get to do this, and you have to enjoy it while it's here and make the most of it.
It's a crazy feeling when something goes from a spark of imagination to something you can hold in your hands. That first cassette was made in 5 fucking days or whatever. And here we are, just like, whoa, how the fuck did this happen? honestly, had I taken this whole career thing seriously, I would have named it something else, because it's the worst fucking band name in the world.